Disclosure was invited by the Panzer Museum and the Tank Museum at Bovington. In this video, we look at Simmerit, that coating that gives German tanks those riffled features. To provide some in-depth info, I looked into the German military archives, and I did some testing with a strong magnet and a real Panzer in a museum. First off, let's take a look at chronology. In November 1942, Germany introduced the Hafthohlladung 3 kg, literally sticky hollow charge 3 kg. This likely was the cause for concern that the enemy might introduce a similar weapon soon, particularly since German manuals noted that this weapon was considered as the best close anti-tank weapon available in their arsenal. As you can see, the weapon has three magnets, its application on vertical or strong sloped armor plates required proper placing. Particularly dirty or concrete coated armor plates would prevent the weapon from sticking to the armor, according to Fleischer. This experience likely influenced the creation of a protective coating for German tanks. In January 1943, the Heereswaffenamt, Army's Weapon Office, conducted trials for countermeasures against sticky demolition charges, Gegenmittel gegen Haftsprengladungen. Looking at the proposed solutions, it is apparent that they are about magnetic anti-tank weapons. The reports note that five countermeasures were selected. Namely, first, coating the armor with concrete milk or concrete number 3, Beton 3, mixed with fine gravel with a thickness of around 3 to 5 mm. Second, coating with asphalt or tar, which is mixed with fine grit, although with the caveat that in hot regions this does not work. Third, as an improvised measure, smearing thicky oily substances like asphalt, tar, oils, etc. Similarly to the previous approach, in hot regions this would create problems. Fourth, it was noted that thick 2 to 3 cm color coating might work, but it was added that this was likely not work. Fifth, in winter, if it was cold enough, dousing the tank with water could create a layer of thick ice that prevents magnetic charges from getting a hold. In February 1943, these solutions were proposed to the armor branch, which responded that the only solution proposed that was acceptable would be number 1. It was particularly noted that the options with tar and similar materials were rejected by the troops due to the fire hazard. Further developments were conducted. Fast forward to early June 1943. The development of the protective paste culminated in a demonstration at the weapons trials facility at Kummersdorf, which I visited a few years ago and made a video about it. Following these demonstrations, on 5th June 1943, the order was given to conduct troop trials. The order specifically notes that the goal of the trial is to test the durability of the coating against magnetic charges and shelling. It was ordered that from Army Group South, the 7th Panzer Division, and from Army Group Center, the 4th Panzer Division, should conduct those trials and proper personnel and material should be sent. Around summer-fall 1943, Simmerit was being applied to newly built tanks. Generally, it was applied by the factories and the introduction was not the same at each location. Jens and Doyle note that from August 1943 the Tiger got Simmerit, while the Panther from September 1943. The name Simmerit, by the way, has no deeper meaning. The company producing it was called Zimmer, and adding the it, this ending in German basically means it's a material. According to Jens and Doyle, in September 1944 the assembly firms were informed that Simmerit would no longer be applied to tanks. This was based on a decision by the Generalinspekteur der Panzertruppen, General Inspector of the Armor Branch, from earlier September 1944, stating that to simplify production the protective coating should be discontinued. Other sources note that this was done due to rumors that the coating would catch fire. Likely it was discontinued since Germany's enemies so far had not introduced magnetic anti-tank charges and production was streamlined continuously in many regards. This was done with tanks, but also with standard bolt-action rifles as well. This brings us to the question if it does burn or cause a fire hazard. According to the materials, it should not, yet the Soviets also did some testing and looked at burned-out tanks as well. The findings from January 1944 were translated by Peter Samsonov from Tank Archives. It is stated, upon analyzing the substance, it was determined that it does not ignite. We have examined a tank that burned and the substance remained. It was only darkened. When the substance is placed in hot water, it does not dissolve, but becomes softer. It reminds me of chalk, but it is neither dead nor cement. Neither sand nor clay are evident. Note that the Soviet report concluded that the purpose of Simmerit was protection against Molotov cocktails and to serve as winter camouflage. Additionally, other sources note that the Germans in November 1944 also conducted tests about the flammability and concluded as well that it was not flammable. Of course, you probably want to know if Simmerit actually worked. For this I did some testing. Here you can see me putting a light with a strong magnet on a Jagdpanzer 4 at the Panzermuseum Munster. As you can see, it does not hold very well. Now keep in mind here that this coating is over 80 years old by this time. Additionally, unless the tank had turned off engines, it would also be at least vibrating. If it was on the move, the magnet likely would fall off immediately. Here you can see how well the magnet holds onto the armor skirt that is only painted, which is far better. Note, I had special permission to do this, so please don't try this yourself. Now the Wheeled Foundation did a similar test a while ago. You should check out their video as well. This leads to the next question. If it was effective or not? Well, considering that basically no one except the Germans and Japanese used magnetic mines in large-scale numbers against tanks, the question is basically moot. As my testing shows, it likely would have been. The next question is, what was Simmerit composed of and how was it applied? Simmerit, according to some sources, was a paste that consisted of 40% barium sulfate, which is nowadays used in combination with zinc sulfide, which makes up 10% of Simmerit, as an inorganic pigment. Additionally, barium sulfate is commonly used as a filler for plastics. Probably the most important aspect of it are that it is non-combustible and insoluble. Polyphenol acetate made up another 25%. According to Wikipedia, this is commonly known as wood glue. As such, I suspect that it was used for its adhesive qualities. 15% were ochre pigment. Since the base coating of German tanks was at times ochre, I suspect it's related to that. Finally, there's 10% sawdust. The Soviets did a lab analysis of Simmerit based on a 20-gram sample. They noted that the paste consisted of 53% barite, 16-17% quartz, and 27% of organic matter. The question is here, of course, how representative the sample was, how contained it was, and how well the analysis was in the first place. Yet the findings seem to be in line with what we know. Barite is basically barium sulfide, so that seems to add up. The organic matter is likely sawdust and ochre pigment. Additionally, we need to keep in mind that the blowtorch was applied as well. As such, the composition in some cases might have been changed. Particularly any flammable or fluid elements had either burned up or evaporated. The quartz, if correct, was likely part of some materials used and or a result of heat treatment. For instance, Wikipedia notes, prasolite, an olive-colored material, is produced by heat treatment. About the application, I have a source that quotes a German Technical Army publication from 1944. Here the paste is called Simmerit Schutzanstrich, Simmerit Protective Coating. The guidelines for application were as follows. The coating is to be applied to all sloped and vertical armor plates on the hull, superstructure and behind the side skirts. The coating should not be applied to side skirts, skirts on the superstructure or turret, turret, commander's cupola, bottom, horizontal fenders, removable equipment, exhaust, lights, and also not on armor plates that are covered by fixed or removable parts, for instance if those parts are behind the track wheels. Note that there are photos of side skirts with applied Simmerit. This could predate the instruction or someone didn't follow instructions. The application had 9 steps. First, cleaning of the area. Second, adding a thin layer of Simmerit with a spatula. Third, whereas it should be applied in a paneled fashion. Fourth, then the mass should dry for 4 hours. Fifth, after which it should be burned down with a blowtorch. Note that the source writes abbrennen, which literally translates to burn down, not dry. Sixth, after this, a 4mm thick coating should be applied with a spatula. Seventh, it is noted that the coating should have grooves so that a strong corrugated surface is created. Eighth, overnight the coating should dry. Ninth, the blowtorch should be applied again. This time the verb is härten, which means hardening. Finally, the required quantities for Simmerit for specific vehicles is provided. 70 kg for a Sturmgeschütz, 100 kg for a Panzer IV, 160 kg for a Panther and 200 kg for a Tiger. As typical, the Sturmgeschütz is the most cost-effective and the Tiger is a resource hog. Now, Simmerit was applied in many patterns. Panzerwald.com lists a total of 11 observed patterns and the respective vehicles they were found on. It is noted that some of them were very rare while others were quite common. Here are a few examples of different patterns from my museum visits. Here we have a Stuck 3F from the Tank Museum at Bovington with an interesting baffle pattern, which is heavily worn out. The Stuck was, according to the plate, built between August 1943 and September 1944. So as of the recording in July 2022, it was at least 77 years and 10 months old. This also suggests that the durability of Zimmerit was quite substantial. Here we have the Jagdpanzer IV of the Panzermuseum in Munster with the grooved pattern. It is very common, so one probably could call it the regular Zimmerit pattern. Next is a Königsdieger from the Tank Museum at Bovington. It was built in July 1944, so a few months before Zimmerit was discontinued. It also has the grooved pattern. Finally, we have another Königsdieger, this time from the Panzermuseum. It has no pattern, although according to the director of the Panzermuseum during the war it had one, but it was lost before the tank arrived at the museum. So keep in mind that the absence of Zimmerit should not be used for dating a panzer's production date. To summarize, Zimmerit was a protective coating for German tanks applied from around summer, fall 1943 to September 1944. It should prevent magnetic anti-tank charges from sticking to armor plates. Since none of Germany's enemy used such mines, it was irrelevant. Ultimately, it was discontinued, likely due to the fact that it was an unnecessary drain on the industry, and by that time the infantry had better anti-tank weapons like the bazooka or Piat, and thus a large-scale use of Allied anti-tank charges was unlikely. Thank you to my Patreon and Subscribestar supporters, big thank you to the Panzermuseum Munster and the Tank Museum at Bovington for inviting me in the past. Thank you for watching, and see you next time.